Jane, her son James, her grandchildren, step-grandchildren, great-granddaughter, and everyone who called her their own. She read the rest of the message following from Martin's here at a different place in the record. President Trump's nominee for the vacancy will receive a vote on the floor of the Senate. The entire Senate is united in thanking God and praying for Justice Ginsburg's family, most especially her daughter Jane, her son James, her grandchildren, step-grandchildren, great-granddaughter, and everyone who called her their own. Mr. President, I ask consent that the following remarks appear at a different place in the record.
Without objection.
President Trump's nominee for this vacancy will receive a vote on the floor of the Senate.
The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Well, here we are. Welcome to a Monday. You know, on Friday, I almost said I dread this being Friday, because it seems like for the last few weeks anyway, every Friday we get devastating news. Either a horrific story like we got Friday, frankly, or just a never-ending barrage of one thing after another, which was the week before. So, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, what a loss. In fact, let me officially begin with this.
So often, as an impediment.
Or not.
Great, good fortune.
Hold on. I guess we're not going to start with that. Nothing like a technical hiccup to get our day started weird. I hope that doesn't hold up, because I'm screwed then, because I have an interview on video. All right. Well, in that case, in that case, let me start by just playing the audio. Although I hate to just play the audio of that. It's a wonderful, wonderful video put together by the Lincoln Project about Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And it's really, really good. Let me see. Now I got to find it. It was the notorious RBG is what they called it. And it goes like this.
So often in life, things that you regard as an impediment turn out to be a great good fortune.
Men and women are persons of equal dignity, and they should count equally before the law.
The idea of a young girl aspiring to be a judge, even more spiritual justice, is a wonderful thing.
The notorious RBG.
Do you have some good advice you might share with us? Yes, I do.
Be someone who holds fast to her convictions and her self-respect.
Be independent. Don't be distracted by emotions like anger, envy, resentment. These just sap energy and waste time.
I am proud to nominate for Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, Judge Ruth Bader Ginsburg of the United States.
People ask me sometimes, when do you think it will be enough? When will there be enough women on the court? And my answer is, when there are nine.
When there are nine. There'll be enough when there are nine. What a loss. So Friday night, finished the show. I'm all happy. It's the weekend and we're here and having dinner. I made a wonderful dinner. I don't remember what it was Friday night, but we're eating. We have the TV on, the news in the background, and it was on CNN. And all of a sudden, Aaron Burnett says, we have breaking news. Let's bring in Dr. Sanjay Gupta. And the minute I heard that, it's like, okay, this can't be good. For a second, I thought, all right, it's a COVID-related thing. It'll be okay. And then, sure enough, the minute I heard Ruth, that was it. Ruth Bader Ginsburg has died. David, his face went into his hands, and I just dropped my fork and was stunned and shocked and saddened and just mortified. I'm still coming to terms with it. Thank goodness she held out as long as she did, because we'd be in worse shape if she hadn't. But here we are, 6 weeks and a day before Election Day. And what are these assholes on the right saying? Oh, we're going to feel that. We're going to feel that. Let's think back 4 years. Actually, four, almost 5 years. Because it was February 13th of 2016 when Antonin Scalia kicked. And he did. He, I guess, had a heart attack in his sleep or something and just, you know, died. Suddenly, there was no warning that it was coming or anything. He just died. February. Election Day was November. But that's when the Republicans, who controlled the Senate then, as they do now, said, we're going to wait until the next president comes along. Really? Seriously? It's just flat out wrong. A couple of things about Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Somebody in the chat room at NicoleSandler.com brought this up. As I put it in What's News, to put an otherworldly stamp on it, Sundown Friday marked the start of Rosh Hashanah, which is one of the Jewish high holy days. It's actually the Jewish New Year, and it's followed a week later by Yom Kippur. And the two, Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, this is the holiest time of the Jewish calendar. And according to Jewish tradition, a person who dies on Rosh Hashanah is known as a tzaddik. Sorry if I'm pronouncing it wrong, because I am not the person to ask about Hebrew. A person of great righteousness. And NPR reporter Nina Totenberg, who happened to be a good friend of Ruth Bader Ginsburg's, explained on Twitter. She said, a Jewish teaching says that those who die just before the Jewish New Year are the ones God has held back until the last moment because they were needed most and were the most righteous. I think that, you know, that probably offers comfort to her family, and that's a good thing. One news item that's circulated in the last few days is that a few days before she died, Ruth Bader Ginsburg said to her granddaughter, quote, my most fervent wish is that I will not be replaced until a new president is installed. Donald Trump, sorry to bring his name into this because, I'd rather just leave it out entirely when talking about someone the likes of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, but there you have it. Donald Trump actually spoke very nicely. He had left his rally wherever he was on Friday night. I don't pay much attention. And as he was getting into the plane, there was a little press gaggle there, and one of the reporters mentioned the death of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And frankly, I saw his reaction, and he seemed not shaken, not upset, but he wasn't laughing. He didn't. A sinister smile didn't spread across his face, which I gave him credit for. And he looked, you know, he looked a little bit concerned, to give him the benefit of the doubt. He's like, oh, really? When did that happen? That just happened. That's bad. That's too bad. She was a really good person. He said something nice about her, believe it or not. And then he went and got on his plane. And not too long after that, he put out a statement saying, absolutely, I'm going to nominate her replacement. Yeah. And then today, was it today? It was this morning. The idiot called into Fox and Fiends and actually said this.
Well, I don't know that she said that.
It was regarding one of the fiends on Fox and Fiends who said, did you hear what her dying last, you know, final wish was? And it was that what I just read to you, that she said, my most fervent wish is that it will not be replaced until a new president is installed. And on Fox and Fiends this morning, he said this.
Well, I don't know that she said that, or was that written out by Adam Schiff and Schumer and Pelosi? I would be more inclined to the second.
Oh,
okay,
God.
You know, that came out of the wind. It sounds so beautiful. But that sounds like a Schumer deal, or maybe a Pelosi or Shifty Schiff. So that came out of the wind.
Hey,
let's see.
Hey, Donald. Because a moment ago I mentioned Nina Totenberg, who's a highly respected journalist and knew Ruth Bader Ginsburg very well. Well, here's what she said.
She told her granddaughter, Clara, that, and there were others in the room who were witness to it, among them her doctor, because I checked, because I'm a reporter. And she told her granddaughter, my most fervent wish is that I not be replaced until after a new president is installed, that my replacement not be named until after a new president is installed. So she was hoping to avoid the maelstrom, the hand-to-hand combat, political combat that we're about to see, and dragging the court into it, because
yep.
You know, these kinds of power plays have consequences, and sometimes they're unforeseen. And she was an institutionalist. She believed in the Supreme Court. She urged people not to try to expand the number of justices.
She did.
She believed in it as an institution.
Yeah, she was against the idea of court packing should they pull the shenanigans that they're obviously going to try to pull now. I'm heartbroken, first of all, because we lost an amazing woman, an amazing role model, and I'm really glad that in this last 6 months of this pandemic, when I, you know, was holed up with my daughter here, I got to really introduce her to RBG. We watched the movie, you know, the CNN film that I think they aired again last night. In fact, I got a text from her late Friday night, because she's not living here anymore. And she texted, Mom, I saw that RBG died. I'm so sorry. Are you okay? Because she's a good kid. And she understood, I think now, the importance of somebody like Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And then, so today, you know, already, it took them no time at all. I think Donald Trump, within an hour after hearing the news of her death, already said, of course, we're going to nominate her successor. Mitch McConnell takes to the Senate floor today. I'm going to play you a clip. It runs 40 seconds. The first part of the clip is Mitch McConnell paying his condolences. Oh, we're so sad. She's a great woman. It's a horrible thing. And then he says, now I'm going to ask Mr. President, that's the person presiding over the Senate at the moment, to please put the next comments elsewhere in the official Senate record, because this piece of shit was segueing from, oh, we're so sorry Ruth Bader Ginsburg is dead, to, oh, we're going to put forth her nominee as soon as possible. But he didn't want it to appear in the Senate records as if he said that right after offering his condolences, which is exactly what he did. I couldn't make this stuff up if I tried, and make no mistake, I wouldn't try. Let's see if I can play this video, if it's going to pull the same nonsense on me again. Let's try it. It's still going to do it.
Mr. President, I ask consent that the following remark at a different place in the record.
I can't do this. It's not working.
President Trump's nomination.
All right. Echo. You know, it's probably something really simple that I did, something really stupid that I can't figure out what I did wrong. But here, let me just play the audio only. This is what I get for trying to be all high tech and everything. Here's Mitch McConnell showing what an asshole he is.
The entire Senate is united in thinking of and praying for Justice Ginsburg's family.
most especially her daughter Jane, her son James, her grandchildren, step-grandchildren, great-granddaughter, and everyone who called her their own. Mr. President, I ask consent that the following remarks appear at a different place in the record.
Without objection.
In a different place in the record.
President Trump's nominee for this vacancy will receive a vote on the floor of the Senate.
But he didn't want that to appear in the record right after he offered his condolences, because what? It's going to show you're a fucking hypocrite? You piece of shit fucking hypocrite. I'm sorry for the explosion of profanities, but I can't help myself. You know, when someone, what did I think, who said it? Was it Molly Ivins? I don't remember. Molly Ivins or somebody wise said, when they show you who they are, believe them. Believe them the first time. I don't know. It's been attributed to a whole lot of different people. I'll say that's who it is. And then there's, you know, the hypocrites. These people are hypocrites galore. First of all, this was Mitch McConnell 4 years ago.
The next justice could fundamentally alter the direction of the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And have a profound impact on our country.
Yeah.
So, of course, the American people should have a say in the court's direction.
Well, of course they should. Unless, unless the incumbent president is a Republican, and then it all bets are off. Lindsey Graham, you remember Lindsey Graham, don't you? Here's Lindsey Graham 4 years ago, and make note that what he's saying, he's trying to backtrack on this statement today. And let me just tell you how he's backtracking, because I'm going to cut him off at the knees before he even begins. If you're ready for this, hold on, I got to pull up the info on the Twitter machine, because this is really just really sickening. the statement that I'm about to play. Well, you know what? Let me play the statement first. I'm sorry, I'm so discombobulated. This is just, I'm having a hard time dealing with this, in case you couldn't tell. So this is Lindsey Graham 4 years ago, after they blocked the Merrick Garland nomination. They held the seat open for almost a year and pulled those shenanigans. And then they seated Brett Kavanaugh, right? Okay, so Brett Kavanaugh, after Trump was elected, they denied Barack Obama his right as the president of the United States to fill an open Supreme Court seat, held it open for almost a year. Trump gets in office under, let's admit it, he didn't win the popular vote, a contested circumstances. Brett Kavanaugh is somehow confirmed, even though we know he's sort of he's got problems, let's put it that way. It was five or six days later, after Kavanaugh was confirmed, that Lindsey Graham made this statement.
The people deserve to be heard.
Oh, sorry, that's Grassley. This is Graham.
I want you to use my words against me.
Okay.
If there's a Republican president in 2016 and a vacancy occurs in the last year of the first term, you can say, Lindsey Graham said, let's let the next president, whoever it might be, make that nomination. And you could use my words against me, and you'd be absolutely right. We're setting a precedent here today, Republicans are, that in the last year, at least of a lame duck 8-year term, I would say it's going to be a 4-year term, that you're not going to fill a vacancy of the Supreme Court based on what we're doing here today. That's going to be the new rule.
Okay. So he said that. That was 4 years ago. That was after Kavanaugh was confirmed. And I'm the reason I keep stressing that is because listen to this from Andrew Desiderio, I believe, of Politico, who just tweeted, Senate Judiciary Chairman Lindsey Graham addresses his reversal on SCOTUS nominations in an election year, writing to committee Democrats, quote, After the treatment of Justice Kavanaugh, I now have a different view of the judicial confirmation process.
Bullshit.
He is a fucking liar. That is
bullshit.
Because that statement was made at the Atlantic Festival or something like that, after Kavanaugh was confirmed. It was 5 or 6 days after Kavanaugh was confirmed. He knows exactly how Kavanaugh was treated, exactly how he deserved to be treated, because he was a teenager having a temper tantrum that he was called on his behavior, on his heinous behavior as a teenager. And he reverted to his teenage ways. Lindsey Graham saw all of that. This was no surprise, but now he has to come up with a reason for reverse you use my words. Oh, we will, Lindsey. We will.
I want you to use my words against me. If there's a Republican president in 2016 and a vacancy occurs in the last year of the first term, you can say, Lindsey Graham said, let's let the next president, whoever it might be, make that nomination.
Okay. We'll let the next president, Joe Biden, make that nomination. Jesus fucking Christ. All right. I need a moment of reverence, right? They work fast. Founder Singh has a Ruth Bader Ginsburg song. You ready for it? Take it away, founders, or I should say, take it away, Ruth. Oh, it says my most fervent is that I will not be replaced until a new president is seated. It opened with a text of her last wish.
Brooklyn born to a mother who inspired me. Top of my class, still no man would hire me. Harvard lost me, later said sorry, granted me an honorary law degree. Made my mark through my heart into every fight, taking on discrimination.
Sing, I am Ruth, and they put that together very quickly. I don't know if that was a parody of another song, or it's a song I'm not familiar with, but good for them for a very, very quick turnaround there. All right, we're going to talk with a young man named Joshua Potash in a little while. I first met Joshua, I want to say about a year ago, when I read about him in Will Bunch's column at the Philadelphia Inquirer. I'm sorry, I'm multitasking here. I'm trying to do more than one thing at a time, mostly because I can't play videos on my streaming thing right now, so I'm trying to get these other videos queued up, but you don't need to know that. Anyway, Will Bunch wrote about Joshua Potash because he has his finger on the pulse of protests across America. And right now, what we need is to organize. Because on the left, we're really not organized. The right, you know, they got their game plan down and they go in full tilt boogie. On the left, we just think, you know, to quote Alexander Vindman, here, right matters. But it doesn't. Because we're as right, we're correct, which is the more accurate term. They're the bad guys, and they seem to be winning. Well, we're not going to let them win on November 3rd, I hope. So we need to be prepared. Anyway, we'll talk about our responsibility as citizens in terms of taking it to the streets. So we'll do that in just a few minutes when Joshua Potash joins us on the Nicole Sandler Show. But while Progressive Voices is in commercials, I thought I'd share with you the comments of a few of the other turncoats. These senators all went on the record 4 years ago and said, oh no, you never put forth a Supreme Court nominee in an election year. It's just not done. For instance, here's Ted Cruz, who's pushing for an immediate new justice to be seated.
President Obama is eager to appoint Justice Scalia's replacement this year. But do you know, in the last 80 years, we have not once has the Senate confirmed a nomination made in an election year, and now is no year to start. This really? Is for the people to decide.
It is.
I intend to make 2016 a referendum on the U.S. Supreme Court.
He did he? Okay. How about little Marco? My senator, Macro, little Macro?
I don't think we should be moving forward on a nominee in the last year of this president's term. I would say that if it was a Republican president.
Ay, ay, ay. And you already heard from Mitch McConnell, right? Well, let me share this with you, if I can find it in my notes, because Chuck Grassley has yet to weigh in. But when he was asked in July, what advice he would give Senator Lindsey Graham, who is his successor as chairman of the Senate Judiciary Committee, who would oversee any hearings on an incoming Supreme Court nominee, Chuck Grassley said that he would not support moving forward with a nomination close to an election. He said that 3 months ago. And this was Chuck Grassley back in 2016.
The people deserve to be heard, and they should be allowed to decide through their vote for the next president the type of person that should be on the Supreme Court. This is a reasonable approach. It is a fair approach, and it is a historical approach.
But he has not yet officially weighed in on what he's going to do. What's the hesitation, Chucky? Should start calling you Chucky Schmucky. Come on, Chuck Grassley. Do the right thing here. You're retiring. You don't owe anybody anything. Do the right thing. But I don't think Republicans know how to do the right thing. It's that sad. There are a few other possibilities. Cory Gardner is one of the most endangered senators up for re-election, obviously. It looks like he's losing badly in the polling to Hickenlooper, the former governor of Colorado. He likes fracking, but again, so does Joe Biden, so we're screwed. Anyway, Cory Gardner, one of the most endangered senators up for re-election, has just sidestepped the question. He won't say anything. And then there's Mitt Romney. Romney has also yet to comment on a future nominee, despite our hopes that he'll quickly join with Collins and Murkowski. A Romney spokesman told the New York Times that he will not take any stance until the GOP conference meets. Huh? Well, the GOP conference meets tomorrow. I don't know what he expects to get, though. I don't know what he thinks he's going to hear. I guess we wait and find out. But here's the thing. If we're able to hold off these loathsome creatures, by that I mean Republicans, until after the election, and hopefully all goes well and Donald Trump loses and a lot of these senators lose their seats too, then they're lame ducks. That is the lame duck session. And I can't imagine, we're talking Republicans here. Anything could happen. Anything could happen, which is why you and I must be prepared. In fact, we so need to be prepared. Let me see. There's I thought I had something else here I wanted to play for you, but now I played you the Lindsey Graham. Oh, this is interesting. Let me play this for you. On CNN, there was a discussion, and the people that were on the panel were Jeffrey Toobin, that's CNN's legal expert. He's their Supreme Court guy. He wrote the book, The Nine, some years ago. Very good book about the Supreme Court. And David Boies. And David Boies represented Al Gore at the Supreme Court in 2000. And this was some of their discussion about where we are now.
If they now flip-flop on that issue, I think that is going to...
Okay, but the issue they're talking about, that was the voice of David Boies. And he's talking about the Democrats' idea to possibly pack the court. So if they succeed in putting through their Amy Comey Bryan or whatever her name is, that when the Democrats take power, they need to install two more Democrats on this, two more justices on the Supreme Court. That's called packing the court. The Constitution does not specify how many justices are seated. So back to, here's what they said.
If they now flip-flop on that issue, I think that is going to not only take us down a road of diminishing the Senate and diminishing the Supreme Court, but it'll take us down a road that requires to rebalance the Supreme Court once the Democrats regain control of Congress.
Yes, exactly.
And the Republicans, of course, have now eliminated essentially the filibuster. So the Republicans have taken the step of taking us down to majoritarian rule without any limitations on that. So I think they are taking us down a road that they are going to rule.
Okay. Well, it's interesting that you say all of that because, Jeffrey, I mean, Chuck Schumer has telegraphed as much. I mean, he's basically saying, if Democrats win the Senate, if Democrats win the White House, Katie, bar the door. You know, they're going to go ahead.
This is Jeffrey Taylor.
He sort of said that. He said nothing's off the table. You know, Democrats are great about talking big, but we'll see if he has the, if he and the other Democrats have the guts to do anything if they retake control of the Senate. Will they really add the two seats?
Why wouldn't they? Why wouldn't they? I mean, if they're in control, why wouldn't they?
Because they're weak and they're wimps and they're afraid.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, the Democrats, you know.
All right. That's enough of that because I'm going to run out of time. But, that, you know, this just shows the level of the discussion going on between David Boies and Jeffrey Toobin. We'll hear more of that tomorrow. In the meantime, let's not wait any longer and let's bring in our guest because the question is, what do we do now? Let's find out. Is Joshua Potash. He's somebody that I met last year through Will Bunch, one of my favorite columnists, of course, at the Philadelphia Inquirer. And Will had written a story, Josh, about your activism and how you seem to have sort of zeroed in on protests globally and lamented that here in the United States, we seem to be kind of off the mark. We're not very good when it comes to protesting, are we?
We are not up to where a lot of us would like to be. There's been a history of huge and wonderful one-day events, you know, and what we've seen throughout the world is that the effective movements to drive out authoritarians take sustained effort, long sustained effort. So I think that's been my focus, or one of my focuses for the past year or so.
Right. And I noticed, if I look for you online, you're very active on Twitter. And I saw you did some writing on Medium and you wrote something about we're done with the one and done protests.
Yeah.
But are we?
That's the question. I wish I had a definitive answer. And the definitive answer is that we need to be. They're beautiful. They empower people, or they make people feel empowered. But they're easy to ignore. You know, even a million people in Washington, D.C. for one day, it'll get media attention. It'll be beautiful. and it will not disrupt the engine.
Right. Then it goes away, yeah. Right? So I think most of us, probably everybody listening in any way they could, participated on January 21st, 2017. We were all out on the streets, and there were a few protests and marches after that, but then things seemed to level off until the murder of George Floyd at the hands of police. And then we took to the streets again, although some of us didn't because of COVID and everything else, all the other craziness that's going on in the world. But in some cities, the protests have not let up. Let's look at Portland, for example. You've covered what's been going on. So what did happen in Portland? They started like everywhere else, but in Portland, they kept going night after night.
Yeah, they did. You know, they didn't stop. And I'm not the foremost expert on Portland by a long stretch. There's so many great local journalists. But what I saw was what you're talking about, unrelenting, you know. And then, the federal response, the fascistic response, drew thousands more. But the people who had been on the ground day after day after day laid the groundwork, you know, for that to even be possible. And one thing you see there is just a protest ecosystem. You know, they have incredible people providing snacks and water and masks and helping each other out in a million different ways and providing mutual aid with the wildfires out there. And so it was the exact opposite of this one and done. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a sustained effort and a whole support system around the people in the streets out there.
Now, Joshua Potash, I'm looking at you on video, and you look young. And so I'm guessing back when the Occupy movement happened, Occupy Wall Street, and it happened in other cities, you were probably too young to participate. Am I right?
Yes, I was. How old was I? I don't know. I was a teenager.
10 years ago. So
I was not in the New Yorker yet.
Right. So that was 10 years ago. And then once the man, put down Occupy, I still remember quite vividly, even though it was just about a decade ago, when they came in and they just rammed through the encampments that were in Washington, D.C., and in lower Manhattan, all around in places around the country, it kind of stopped for a while. And then I noticed you had take note of protests going on around the world, most notably, I guess, in France and other countries. And you pondered the question, why can't we do this here? Were you encouraged when you saw how many people took to the streets following the murder of George Floyd?
Yeah, I think, you know, between Occupy and these recent protests this summer, the only sustained mass protest movement was the Black Lives Matter movement of 2014 and 15. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's clear that message just resounds for so many people. And I think what we've seen this summer is, you know, it's one thing I'm seeing that's encouraging is that there's a growing number of people who understand that an anti-police brutality movement, a movement to defund the police, goes hand in hand with an anti-fascist movement, because police officers and police unions and bosses, you know, their union bosses are increasingly, their actions are increasingly aligned with fascism. But then the biggest NYPD union has overtly endorsed Trump, you know,
yes.
Openly endorsed
yep.
Trump.
So, yes, they have.
You know, I'm encouraged for a number of reasons, but I think there's the biggest, most encouraging thing is the knowledge demonstrated through these actions and through these ongoing mass protests that our politicians alone are not enough to save us. They're not,
not close.
As I think you and anybody listening is probably already aware of. Politicians are either scared of the police or unwilling to defund the police for whatever the reason may be. Politicians are by and large unwilling to call out fascism.
It's weird, isn't it, that there's this,
yeah.
You know, we're looking at fascism, you know, beating down our door, and you have the president screaming that Antifa, which just simply means anti-fascist are terrorists. I mean, I have a thing I call opposite world. It's where we live. It's in is out, up is down. The sky is green. It goes with their gaslighting and constant lying where you can't believe anything that's said. So I guess, and now on Friday night, we got word of just the worst possible thing that could have happened, you know, less than 2 months out from the election, which is the death of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who was the glue that was holding us together, I think, keeping fascism from beating down our doors. And so now, despite what they did 4 years ago, when they held open a Supreme Court seat for almost a year, because they didn't want President Obama to bring in another justice, they're saying within 2 months, they're going to not only nominate someone, but ram them through the Senate, and we're screwed. So this is a time, if ever there were a time, for us to organize and say, hell no, you're not doing this. You are not taking another Supreme Court justice away from us. I noticed, I always follow you on Twitter at Joshua Potash. I'll put a link on the blog at NicoleSandler.com. So anybody who's listening the audio and doesn't see it written in front of them on the screen can follow you as well. But I noticed you were inviting people to join another, I guess, social media group or another board. What is Telegram?
It is anonymous chat rooms, back to the old school internet in a way. Mm-hmm. There's encrypted apps like Signal. There's very public forums like Twitter, and this is in some ways a middle ground. It's anonymous chat rooms that can hold and do hold, have thousands of people. Some friends of mine over a year ago were inspired by what they've seen, how they've seen it used in Hong Kong to protect people's anonymity while they post, information about protests and stuff. The usage of it in the States has grown through the Black Lives Matter movement this summer, the insurrection this summer, and it also is something like Ruth Bader Ginsburg death has sparked more use. I think there's what we're seeing is almost daily now signs that mass movements are urgent and are necessary, increasingly every day. Even a few hours ago, Bill Barr decided to officially declare three normal American cities anarchist jurisdictions, and
anarchist jurisdictions. He did that today. What does that mean?
Amazing.
What does that mean?
Well, I guess there's probably two answers to that or more.
Yeah, there's one that Bill Barr has and there's one that the rest of us.
Yeah, exactly. His definition, that was endorsed by one of the NYPD bosses already. Is that these are criminal, lawless cities where the politicians are not protecting the police or something of that nature, and therefore they're anarchist jurisdictions. While the reality is that there are almost 40,000 NYPD officers crushing, for the past 3 days in a row, they've crushed anti-ICE protests every single day, illegally often, the endless irony of them being the ones to break the law. And the other irony being, you may have seen New Yorkers, assorted New Yorkers post, it's a lovely fall day. nothing is burning. Nothing is, nobody, I am not afraid to go anywhere in this city. It's actually a remarkably safe city, as I've heard about Seattle and
Portland.
Portland,
New York, Seattle and Portland are anarchist cities. So I'm looking at NBCNewYork.com. New York City is one of three places that, quote, have permitted violence and destruction of property to persist and have refused to undertake reasonable measures to counteract criminal activities, leading to its designation as an anarchist jurisdiction today, according to the Justice Department. This is fascism, as far as I'm concerned. This is exactly what we are fighting or need to fight. And so that's one of the reasons you're inviting people to meet up on Telegram. It's a way to be anonymous. You can join groups. There's a big room, and it's an unlimited number of people with anonymous screen names who can then sign on to smaller groups, which are split up by geographical designation around the country. I live in Florida, so I joined onto the Southeastern group. And interesting, when I joined in, it was a few days ago, when the big story was that ICE detention center in Georgia that was mass sterilizing women by performing hysterectomies on them. It's just insane. And so the discussion in that room was centered on this Georgia facility, but I could see how if there's a mobilization for a protest regarding Ruth Bader Ginsburg or whatever it might be, that it's an easy way to get to people and get them all on the same page at once. And I guess that's the reason that these groups have formed.
Exactly. No, in that room when I was, I don't live in that area, but what I was told is that, you know, a protest did materialize at that, what is it, IDIC? Detention center.
A detention center. Concentration camp.
Concentration camp. Yeah, far more accurate term. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and I mean, I think the basic premise of everything I attempt to do, and, you know, a lot of people I respect and talk to attempt to do, is explain that fascism requires a response, and that response cannot be an angry letter. That response, or it cannot be just an angry letter. Send as many letters as you want, you know, but also get out in the streets. The terrifying, sometimes, you know, or intimidating reality is that fascism does not simply get voted out. We are going to try. I know, you know, millions of people are going to try their best. But we know that the president and all his cronies and everybody surrounding him are committed to stealing the election. You know, they say it openly. So, you know, he talks openly about, you know, mail-in voting is fraudulent, which is a lie.
Yep.
And then he'll go and encourage people in North Carolina to vote twice. And then, you know, the huge part of the Supreme Court battle is that might be their last line of defense in their effort to steal this election. So
it is astounding, because after what they did in 2016, following the death of Antonin Scalia, where they held open the seat now occupied by Brett Kavanaugh, which is just vomitacious. Yeah. And they're and now the hypocrisy is just stunning. Again, I mentioned opposite world. Here, this is what I mean by opposite world.
Everything you thought you knew, you never knew it all. Sideways is straight ahead. Facts no longer matter. Reality is now fiction. There's a signpost up ahead. Your next stop, opposite world.
So, I mean, I could play all the sound clips I want, but the reality is, unless we do something, I mean, what is that? Do you know, Joshua, are there any events, any protests, any mass marches, anything planned to stop the grab of this Supreme Court seat?
Yeah. Thankfully there are. You know, there's an incredible group called Shutdown DC, and it's a model that really could be replicated and should be replicated in every major city. It's a coalition of fantastic organizations that kind of came together, and Shutdown DC is the coalition, the name
the
of
umbrella
the
group, right?
The umbrella group, exactly. And, you know, there's folks from Black Lives Matter, there's climate activists, there's immigrant rights activists or undocumented activists, and they effectively shut down, I believe, a dozen or more intersections last year at a climate protest, and that was just the start, from what I understand. So they're hosting trainings. They're kind of hosting more theoretical talks, you could say, about what they are planning to do or what they should do. And they are the one, you may have seen protests outside of Louis DeJoy's home.
Yes,
DC.
I saw that. And there was a protest outside of Mitch McConnell's home last night.
Yeah, and Lindsey Graham's house.
Oh, and Lindsey Graham, too.
So
yeah.
People are starting to escalate, you know, because, like we were just talking about, fascism requires a response that is appropriate to the threat. You know, if somebody is, you may have talked about, I know I've talked about, the history of Democrats bringing a spoon to a gunfight, you know, not even a knife. And, you know, that's my childhood, was seeing them roll over in 2000 for George Bush.
Yep.
Seeing John Kerry get those Swift Boat ads, and what was the Democratic response? I don't know. So now these people shut down DC, you know, they want to shut down the city if they attempt to basically go back on their word and steal a Supreme Court seat.
Amazing. Well, one other question though about protests. Protests, when you say protest or an action, you're talking about a peaceful protest, right? The acts of violence that are going on are not coming from within the group of organizers or protesters or the movement. In many cases, these are outside agitators, and I would submit that there are people on the other side who are doing this to ratchet up the discord, the chaos, to make trouble for the peaceful protesters. Am I wrong here?
I think there's at least one very, very clearly documented case in the Twin Cities, Minneapolis, where a man was going with a hammer and breaking windows, and activists confronted him. And I think he actually turned out to be a police officer.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, that's the case that I think of. Mm-hmm. And I think, I don't know overall, you know, I think there is a, say when Jacob Blake is brutally shot like seven times for absolutely no reason other than racism. I'm not surprised if somebody in anger, you know, threw a brick or threw something or
a can of soup.
Yeah, the stereotypical.
But here's the thing: it's violence and anarchy if somebody throws a can of soup. But when they drive through with truckloads of people with paint gun pellets firing at people, that's all fun and games. That's harmless fun. I don't think so.
No, exactly. I mean, that's the connection before, where it's clear that police officers are on the side of the white supremacists or are themselves white supremacists. Mm-hmm. I mean, an NYPD boss went on camera with a Q mug, a QAnon mug, you know, and that's not a coincidence. You know, that's, even if it is, that means he's a QAnon believer. It's just, you know, they're endorsing Trump. They are in Portland. You've seen things like Proud Boys come into town, and literally police do not show up until the Proud Boys withdraw because they were pushed back by anti-fascist and Black Lives Matter supporters. And then the police come and start policing the
good guys,
the gathering, the gathering of Black Lives Matter supporters. So it's, I think the important point you're making is that there has been a very selective application of this rhetoric, you know, the rhetoric of agitator and violence, and it's used when a window is broken, but it's not used when people come through in trucks macing people and the countless cars ramming into protesters. I mean, it's in New York City, which the liberal bastion or whatever, you know, police have rammed their cars into protesters near Barclays in June. And about 2 weeks ago, Trump supporters rammed their car into protesters by Times Square. And I personally witnessed at least three people get injured from that. And the NYPD also witnessed it.
And there's nothing there, because if they're on that side, apparently it's okay. It's only if you're a liberal or a progressive or you believe in Black Lives Matter that you're the bad guy. This is the picture that's being painted by this administration and this Justice Department, which makes protesting right now even more dangerous. We are in a really rough period right now, I'd say, from now until January 21st. Anything can happen. And I want to help people know. And one of the reasons I asked you to join us today is to give my listeners an opportunity to join in some groups so they know what's going on. One way would be the Telegram. Right. So how do people join that? You want to give information or should I just put it on my blog?
Really, it's just download the app. It's called Telegram Messenger. Link in bio. It's the link in my bio on Twitter. Will take you to like a welcome room and get you sorted.
SOS room one. Then from there, you move on to find something that's more geographically in line with you. So it's a good way to be in touch with other people. You can remain anonymous. It's a good way to keep from the
you can hide your phone number.
The man coming after you.
No, nothing. Right. Yeah.
But the bottom line is we must be organized and we must be in contact with each other, because I think things are going to get really hairy the closer we get to November 3rd and the few days after that. And lucky me, my birthday is the 4th. I was thinking we're going to have a big old party on the 4th. And this time I'm thinking, this time, you know, the only way it's going to be a big old party is if Donald Trump is defeated so resoundingly. It's such a landslide victory over him that it's clear and apparent the American people want you out of here. So that's the first thing we all must do, is make sure we can vote. Make sure your registration is in order and that you vote as soon as you can. The other thing is get in touch, connect with people. And a good way to do it is through this Telegram group. I'll put the link on my blog at NicoleSandler.com with today's show, but also follow Joshua Potash, JOSHUAPOTASH on Twitter. And the link is in his bio. Sign up. If nothing else, you'll just be aware of what's happening. And Joshua, what kind of, I know you've studied how protests are happening globally. Any sense of what the rest of the world is thinking about what's going on here right now?
I mean, I've personally received comments from friends in the UK and Lebanon and South America, and it's fear is the number one thing that I, you know, regardless of the many, many problems with the U.S. And you know, oligarchy and imperialism, and there's an undeniable truth that whatever modicum of stability we've had in the world is largely based on some of the stability in the U.S. And I mean, they've, for the past couple of years, they've often with clearer eyes and a clearer head, I think, been seeing this transition towards fascism. Yeah. And so, yeah, I think there's a lot of fear. And I think what I've heard, even, you know, from very radical people in other parts of the world, I've heard that they agree with what you've been saying just now, that we just need to defeat Trump. And if the smoothest and easiest and best way would be an overwhelming, crushing victory.
That's it.
On November 3rd and 4th. But, yes. You know, I think there's Democrats and Biden supporters who aren't Democrats, independents, whatever, anti-Trump people who don't support Biden.
Look, I don't support Biden, but I understand my duty is to vote to get Trump out of office. And the most efficient way to do that is to vote for Joe Biden. And you know what? The next day we start protesting, we fight against Joe Biden. Yeah. He'll be easier to fight than Donald Trump and his army of fascists.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, I think one of the trickiest things is that people who oppose Trump are, what, 4 times more likely to vote by mail than people who support Trump. So that there is another, it's not a group, it's another coalition called Protect the Results. And it's a coalition of pretty well-known organizations, you know, Indivisible is in there and Center for Popular Democracy and these big organizations. And I believe their thought is that between the night of November 3rd and the morning of November 4th, in-person polls might say great things for the Trump campaign.
All you have to do is look at 2000, because this is what happened here in Florida, because Fox even had called it for Gore. And overnight, things happened. And when we awoke the next morning, all of a sudden, they had taken their call back. Yep. And we see what happened. So that's a very important thing. Protect the vote.
I think about 2000. My grandmother, who would rather cut her arm off than vote for a Republican, was confused by the ballot that day, you know. And yeah, I think about that a lot. And so this Protect the Results, there's a legal arm to that, but there's also a component of we will need to shut things down if he tries to declare a victory based on in-person ballots.
Absolutely. You know? And this is when we all need to be on alert. So again, a good reason to join these groups. Joshua Potash, I'm going to suggest everybody follow you on Twitter, join this Telegram group, stay involved and stay on top of it, because it's going to be up to us. There's nobody coming to save us. And if we don't take the initiative to do it, to save ourselves, well then, I hate to say it, but I guess we get what we deserve, or we deserve what we get. And I'm not willing to give on that. So, you know, I've said this so many times, my generation let us down. The generation that followed me, I'm old, let us down. You guys, you're the ones that I have so much faith in and so much pride in, that I really think it's, I don't want to call you a kid, young people, young adults your age are the ones who are going to save us. And thank you for that. I'm so impressed by, and I don't know what the name is, Generation Z, or do you have a name? The woke, or although I hate that too. The youth of America.
Yeah.
So thank you for stepping up, because you're doing what people in between your age and mine didn't do. So I have faith in you. Lead the way. I'm here to follow.
No, thank you. I've been inspired. You know, I've most of my inspiration, and literally when I started, you know, really becoming a regular in the streets was Black Lives Matter organizers. You know, I went to college in St. Louis and got to meet amazing people out there, and I'm from Baltimore, and amazing people out there, and same with New York right now, and Portland, and all over. So yeah, if there's a time for all of us to come together and fight this fight, it's right now.
It's now. All right, we'll do it in Ruth Bader Ginsburg's name and John Lewis's name. We'll create good trouble.
Yeah.
Joshua Potash, thank you for the work you're doing. I will be following you and taking a cue from you and your friends and colleagues, put it that way. Thank you so much. Thanks for joining us today, and thanks for the work you're doing. It's really, really important.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it tremendously.
Bye, everyone. See you tomorrow.